This here, as it refers to in verse 8, is called in the NIV the beginning of birth pains. Some translations say it's the beginning of sorrows that will come upon the earth, okay? That is the phase that we are in right now. If you ask, Pastor, which phase are we in, biblically speaking, I would answer, we are in the birth pains right now on planet Earth. What comes after that? The rapture of the church. The rapture of the church is next on God's agenda for the church. You think Star Trek is cool? You think Star Wars is awesome? Wait till you hear about what the Bible has to say about the church and what's going to happen to the church in the very near future. So the rapture of the church is next. After that is the great tribulation, period, that's going to come upon the earth. I'm pretty sure you've seen movies and billboards all talking about the great tribulation since the day we were born, okay? Well, that's going to come after that. After the great tribulation will come what the Bible calls the millennium or the millennial reign of Jesus Christ, which is 1,000 years of Jesus reigning on the earth. We'll get to that, okay? And the last part is new heaven and the new earth. After all of this is done, in the end, God is going to, according to the Bible, restore a new earth, bring a new earth, a new heaven, and it's going to be the Garden of Eden again. Okay, so God's whole intention is to restore everything to its original plan. And he goes through these steps that I just mentioned, but the goal is to reach that ultimate end, which is to restore earth back to its original creation. That sounds good to me. Amen. He's the master builder. He knows what he's doing. So today, let's go to the birth pains. Let's back up now. Let's go back to the first part of where we are at. We are right at the beginning. It's called birth pains. Now, why birth pains? Well, if you're a woman, you know what I'm talking about. If you're a guy and you're married and you have children, you know a little bit of what I'm talking about. Amen. Nobody saying amen today? Because if you're a father here and you saw your wife have a child, or if you're a mother, of course, you know what it's all about. But birth pains, they come sometimes every 5 minutes when you're about to give birth to a child. Sometimes every 10 minutes, but the pain is there. But the intervals between one pain and the other are sometimes spread apart by 10, sometimes 5 minutes. But as time goes by, it begins to shorten. Then every 3 minutes, then every 2 minutes, then every 1 minute. And then finally, the baby is born, right? Boy, do I remember those days. My wife would say things to me that a Christian would never say in those moments. Because it is painful. I don't know how painful it could be, but from the look on her face and from the words that were coming out of her mouth, I can guarantee you, it is painful. So when the Bible says birth pains, it's referring to that. Okay, the actual Greek says birth pains. It's saying in this season of planet Earth that will lead up to the rapture and the great tribulation, it'll be like the birth pains that a woman experiences. You know, it's going to start less, maybe every 10 minutes she'll get the birth pains. But then as time goes by, it'll get worse. So that leads to the question that you probably have in your mind right now. Are things going to get better or are things going to get worse? The answer is the latter. Things, I think, are going to get worse on the face of the earth. Now, before you get into depression, before you get worried and concerned about your life, about planet Earth, if you are a Christian, there's no need for you to be concerned. Because the Bible says that the Father, if he cares for a bird, a sparrow, will he not much more care for you? Amen. So no matter what happens on planet Earth, you will be taken care of by your Father in heaven. The Bible says, he who watches Israel neither slumbers nor does he sleep. He doesn't take naps in between, nor does he believe in siestas, okay? He is always watching you and caring for you. Amen. Amen. Not one hair, Jesus said, of your head, not one hair of your head will be not counted for. Amen. Amen. Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? When they went into the fiery furnace, they came out on the other side. How? Perfectly. Not one burnt mark on your body. Not even the smell of ash was upon their body. That's what God does for his believers. So no matter what is coming on the face of the earth, you will be cared for and protected. Believe that. Amen, church? Tap your neighbor and say, don't worry. You will be protected. He will take care of you. Okay? Amen. The first thing that Jesus says here, okay, in verse 5, he says, watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name claiming I am the Christ. Now, you've seen that. People come left and right and say, oh, I am Jesus. They're even bold enough to say, I am Jesus. I'm like, no, you're not. You may be a Jesus, some other Jesus, but you're not the Jesus, saying the Messiah, the Yeshua. You're not that Jesus, not at all. So he's warning us. If anybody comes saying, I am the Messiah, I've come from God, I am the next messenger, I am the next prophet. Unfortunately, in Islam, they say that. The Bible is something that you should not take very seriously. There's a new revelation. The prophet Muhammad is now the spokesperson for God. That's a lie. The only spokesperson that God ever approved in the Bible is Jesus Christ. Right after the baptism, it was the Father who spoke audibly and everybody heard it and says, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Mary said at the feast when he turned water into wine, she said to the people who wanted to speak to her, she said, no, you go talk to him. Him is the one you need to talk to because he has your answer. The only prophet, the only mediator that is recognized in heaven and we should recognize is our mediator, the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in the book of Acts, there is given unto man no other name by which we should be saved but the name of Jesus. Amen. So it's through that name, it's in that name. So if anybody comes representing, saying, I am the Christ, you just say, well, you know, good for you, but you're not the Jesus, the Messiah that the Bible speaks of. You're definitely not. So he said in the last days there's going to be an increase of this, okay? And it has been happening. Next thing he says is you will hear of wars and rumors of wars, okay? Wars and rumors of wars. When it comes to wars, this phrase in the Greek is in the present tense, which means this, that you will be continually hearing about wars. And isn't that true? I mean, what is everybody talking about today? North Korea. Not too long ago, what was the main theme in news? It was ISIS. Now, ISIS is almost defeated, by the way. I don't know if you know this, but they are practically defeated in the Middle East. Now that that is almost gone, now we have North Korea. Rocket Man, as Trump calls him there, is threatening to send a missile to us, right? And I believe they're only threats. Well, once that's done, then what's next? There's always going to be something else, okay? He said, this is going to be continually, you're going to be continually hearing about this, and it's going to increase. It is going to increase. As a matter of fact, I pulled some statistics, and this is what I discovered. This is real. Watch this. From the year 1274 BC before Christ to 22 BC before Christ, there has been 21 wars. 21. But from AD 1, which is the year Domini, which is the year of Christ, year 1, to currently today, 2017, there has been 155 wars. So basically, in a span of 1,262 years, there has been 21 wars, but in a span of 2,017 years, there has been 155 wars. Even if you were to multiply by two the 1,262 years, you would only get 42 wars, which will not even come close to how many wars there has been since day one up until today. You get the picture? That represents seven times more wars. But it's 2,000 years. Well, let me explain this to you. When the Bible says the end times, it's not saying 2017, even though it is the end of times. But when the Bible refers to the end times, it's referring to the period where Jesus was resurrected to the time when he returns. That's the end times. That's the time where God is finishing up, wrapping up everything that he intended to do on planet Earth. So from the day of the resurrection of Christ till today and maybe tomorrow or next year or who knows how much more time to come, that is what the Bible speaks of as the end times. Now, how do we know that we are at the end of end times? Things are getting worse. And we have the data to prove it. From the beginning of his resurrection till 2017, everything on earth, including nature itself, has been progressively getting worse and worse and worse. That's why Jesus calls it the birth pain period. You start out with little pain, then as time goes by, the pain increases even more and more until the baby is birthed. The birthing of the baby represents the coming of Jesus Christ to the earth. So does this make sense to you? Do you understand what I just said? I hope so. Amen. Okay. So, wars. Then he says rumors of wars. In the Greek, it literally means unconfirmed reports which may or may not be true. So you're going to hear rumors of war. Now, North Korea, for example, was threatening. Now, I just heard this week that, you know, President Trump says, no, I don't think we're going to get into war. We're going to work it out in some other way. So what do we see here? We see rumors. We see threats. But Jesus already foretold us. He says, these will be reports that will be ongoing, and some will be true, some will not be true. Okay? Now, as believers, when you know this, you don't worry. Because Jesus already foretold this was going to happen. For the world, when they hear the threats that, you know, they make from North Korea towards us, people will become really fearful and start living in caves and start buying homes in the middle of the country and making it into a fortress. Have you seen that? The preppers? You ever see their homes? Some of their homes go 100 feet in the ground. Bunkers. And it's the latest fad. When we were facing Hurricane Irma, I went to buy some military food because military food lasts for years. And it's a full, complete meal. No more left. And they explained why. They said, number one, because of all the hurricanes this year, and number two, because of all the preppers. Doomsday preppers. They're buying up everything. Because they're afraid. Because they see no hope for the future except go underground and try to survive. You see? I'm not saying you shouldn't protect yourself, but by all means, you should protect yourself. Do as much as you can. But in your heart, you don't need to be so afraid. Because first of all, Jesus already said these things will happen. And secondly, he will take care of us. And if anything does happen, if the worst happens to us, we die, we're only going to be promoted back to heaven. Amen. So we're good. But these people who are hopeless find their hope in building fortresses. You see, so that's, you can get to that extreme where you actually just withdraw yourself from society and go live in a mountain somewhere in the middle of nowhere because you want to be protected. But as we read this, we say, hey, the same Lord that knew what was going to happen is the same Lord who is in control of all things, and he is in control of my life, in my future. Can you say amen to that? Amen. So Jesus said it very clearly. He says, when you hear about wars and rumors of wars, look at it again. In verse 6, he says, do not be alarmed. He says, do not be alarmed. You should not be alarmed of such, because such things must happen. But the end is still to come. Or in other words, there's still more things that's going to happen. Okay? Do not be alarmed. It's in the Greek present imperative, which means don't let this emotion set in. Don't let this emotion settle into your heart and lead you into escapism. Go about your life, people. Work, enjoy your day. You know, look at the signs, like, you know, the sign by my house called Orlando that my wife never saw. Look at the signs. And the more you see the things happening, say, thank you, Lord. The pains are getting closer. And very soon, Jesus is about to be seen in the clouds. So thank you, Jesus, that all these things are going to happen. I don't need to worry. And if you need to protect yourself, just like you protect yourself and you take care of your belongings when a hurricane comes, you do whatever you need to do to protect yourself, but don't go into escapism. And remember, life is not all this. Life is about loving God and loving each other. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Amen. Then he says, nation against nation. Look at this. Verse 7, nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. Nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, okay? Nation here is the Greek word ethnos, where we get the word ethnicity, all right? When you fill out an application, it says on the bottom, what's your ethnicity? That's where the word comes from. It means race or tribe. Race or tribe, okay? So when he refers here to nations, he's not just referring to nations like the United States, North Korea, China, or any other nation. He's actually referring to races and communities and sects that exist within the nation. They will also rise up against each other. I pulled a report from the Global Terrorism Index for 2014. And they said that there are three main factors that correlate to terrorism on the face of the earth. He says the number one factor for terrorism on the face of the earth is high social hostilities between different ethnic, religious, and linguistic groups. I don't know what you're thinking right now, but the moment I read this, I said, aha, it's been predicted. That's why we have so much hostilities between Muslims and other religions. You know, the nation of Pakistan was split from India back in 1949, I think, because of ethnos, because they were Muslims. They did not want to coexist with the Hindus in India. Therefore, they split, and now they're a different country. And how much hostility do you see today, even in Europe, even the United States? 9/11 that we went through in the year 2000 was all about this. Muslims who hate Christian America. So it's not, you know, oh, you mean, oh, but they hate America. No, but what does America stand for around the world? Still stand for. America still stands for Christianity. Now, of course, there's a lot of people who don't believe here, but if you travel around the world and you look at the United States, the first thing that they believe the United States represents is their faith in Christ. And the war, or the declared war, the terroristic war, that Muslims have against the United States, not because it's America or we're Americans, no, it's because America is a Christian nation, and we still send more missionaries around the world than any other nation. So it's a religious, it's an ethnic war, people. You understand? And this has been going on for many, many years. Even in our own country today, we see now the rise of neo-fascism. We see neo-Nazis. We see white supremacy rising up in our nation. And along with that, we see the blacks also counter-attacking white supremacy. And this friction, this tension is in our nation. And that's not just our nation. If you go to other places around the world, if you go to Europe, you're going to see a lot of that. Okay, and these things are happening right now. And the bad news is it's going to continue. And it may get worse. Okay? Because Jesus said it would get worse. Like the increased pains of a woman that's about to give birth to a child. It's going to increase. Okay? Now, is it wrong? Yes, it is. But because Jesus said it would happen, because there is sin in the heart of man, these things are going to happen more and more. So I'm glad Jesus warned us of all this, prepared us for all this. Okay? Now, as Christians, what are we supposed to do in all of this? Be examples. You know, I pray that my church is such a melting pot that it shows the world how in Christ, black, white, Hispanic, Chinese, whatever, whoever, we can all come together, love each other. There's no tension, no racism. That will be so opposite of what the world is facing today and will face tomorrow. When they come through those doors, they're going to see a black kissing a white person hugging a Chinese person hugging a Brazilian. They may not be able to understand each other, maybe, you know, linguistical barriers, but they love each other. Amen. Love is a universal language. Amen. 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 That's my dream. I want a multicolored, multi-ethnic, multilingual, multi-everything. Because with all that comes multi-foods from around the world. And that's good. Amen, church. Amen. I had a dream not too long ago where 90% of our church was Brazilian. 90%. I'm going to share a little bit about that next week. 90%. I know because I walked in here, this place was so packed. There was people everywhere. We looked like ants. An ant mound. When you step on it, all the ants come out. This is what it looked like. It looked like a big, big, it was disorganized. It was disorganized because there was just too many people here. For me to walk from that door to the stage, it took me at least a half an hour. Because I had to walk a little stop, let people through, walk a little stop, let people through. And I looked around and I noticed that 90% were Brazilians. But I said, okay, since we're all Brazilians now, I guess I have to preach in Portuguese. Is that what you guys want? What do you guys want? Everybody in unison said, no, preach in English. Even the Brazilians. So that tells me that our church is going to attract a lot of Brazilians. The newcomers, but especially those who have been here for many years already, who have children, who grew up here like me. I grew up here since the 1970s. But I can relate to both sides. I can relate to the newcomer as the people who've been here for a long time. And that's amazing. So when the world sees a church that embraces everybody, embraces the Brazilians, embraces the Hispanics, embraces the Haitians, embraces everybody and loves them and brings them in, okay? I mean, they're going to look at that and say, whoa, there's something special going on in here. What is it? Okay? While the world is chaotic, here there is peace. There's refuge here for everyone who seeks it. Isn't that good news? Amen. Tap your neighbor and say, that's good news for you, brother. Really good news. Okay? Let's move on quickly. Verse 7, famines. Today, there's 815 million people that are still going hungry. 815 million. Okay? 815 million. That's a lot of people. Okay? Earthquakes. I don't think I need to elaborate about that one, right? We just had a recent one in Mexico. Last year, we had Fukushima, the Fukushima plant, which was destroyed, spread radiation because of an earthquake in the middle of the, not in the middle of the ocean, off the coast of Japan, which produced a tsunami. And the rest is history. But earthquakes are even increasing. Persecution. Did you know that every month, 322 Christians are killed for their faith? Every month. 214 churches and Christian properties are destroyed. And 772 forms of violence are committed against Christians, which includes beatings, abductions, rapes, arrests, and forced marriages. Every month. What? This is happening? Yes. I don't see it. Of course, you're in a bubble. United States is a bubble. There's no such, there's not, the persecution here is really, can even be compared to what people go through in the Middle East as Christians. Okay, when people in the Middle East get saved, they have to literally watch out for their lives. Okay, and in some places in Africa too. Signs in heaven. This one really blew me away. Luke 21:11. If we can put that up there. Luke 21:11. And I'm going to show you a picture, and we're going to finish with that. It says, there will be great earthquakes, famines, pestilences in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven. Okay? Signs from heaven. Put that picture up there for me, please, that I gave you. If we have it. Do you have it there? I hope we have it, because this really was interesting. We have it. We don't have it. We will have it. Very soon. No, we'll get there. Okay, I would sing a song right now to fill in the space. But then you will probably stone me or throw. There it is. Okay, all right. This here was amazing. I've never seen this happen. As a matter of fact, the astronomists, they said that this event that I'm going to show you only happened once in the total span of humanity, 7,000 years. So this never happened before. Never in the history of human civilization. And this happened, what I'm about to show you, September. We were in October last month. Okay. This is interesting because in Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, it says, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars, and she being with child cried, travailing in birth and pained to be delivered. If you read Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, there it's referring to Mary and the birth of Jesus. Revelation 12, 1 and 2. It's a direct reference to Mary when she was pregnant with Jesus, gave birth, and the Son of God appeared. Now, we just read in Luke 21, it talks about how in the last days there's going to be signs in heavens for us to wonder. Now, there's many. There's meteorites that are threatening to destroy us. What else? There's the four blood moons, okay? There's so many signs that you can look for in heaven, but this one here really, I mean, spoke a lot to me. First of all, it said, a woman clothed with the sun. Here's the sun. It's standing, it's positioned right behind her. See the woman right here? Now, the woman represents the constellation Virgo, okay? And I hear a beautiful guitar playing. Praise God, I'm almost done, okay? And it said that the moon would be under her feet in September, between the 21st and the 23rd of September, which, by the way, is the feast of Rosh Hashanah, the Feast of Trumpets, okay, is when this happened. And in those days, in those 2 days, the moon was positioned right here by her feet. You see here? Sorry, Vinny, I have to go in front. Right here, the moon. First time in history that the moon was positioned at the feet of the constellation Virgo. Exactly like Revelation chapter 12 said. And the sun positioned right behind her. And it said, upon her head with a crown of 12 stars. If you count all the stars here, Mercury, some are planets, Mercury, Mars, Venus, Regulus, and all others, they formed a constellation of Leo. And I'm pretty sure you heard about people talking how for the first time the stars were going to be aligned in history. And it happened in September. This is it. They were all aligned. But together, they formed a constellation of Leo, which formed a crown above her head. Isn't that interesting? And the most interesting, it said that she was with the child, and she was travailing in birth and pain to be delivered. That's Revelation chapter 12. Jupiter, right here, is called in astronomy the king planet. Why? Because it's the largest planet in our solar system. So it's called the king planet. King as in King Jesus. Get it? And 9 months ago, so 9 months, that would be December, I believe. 9 months before September, okay, Jupiter was right here. You see the 12? This represents the virgin being pregnant. So the seed went into the womb. And as time progressed, as time went by, Jupiter remaining up here starts to slowly work its way down, until in September it was here. In other words, it was in the womb and it started going out to the day where the child will be birthed in September. Isn't that crazy? In December, it was here. In September, it was positioned here as if it was just given birth to. 9 months later. Isn't that crazy? How long does a woman hold a fetus or a womb inside of her? 9 months. The planet was here, and in 9 months, it moved down here to represent the birthing of a child. Astronomers saw this, and by the way, Virgo represents virgin, the Virgin Mary. This is crazy. So this, Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, this is one of the main signs that the Lord was giving to everybody on earth. He was saying, my son, Jesus, he was speaking in the language that astronomers understand and can relate to everybody else. He was saying, here's a sign in heaven for you. This is what happened in history. A virgin gave birth to a king. His name is Jesus. And he is the Savior of the world. And I'm giving you a sign in the heavens for you to see this. I believe it's in Genesis chapter 1, verse 14, where it says that God gave us the stars in the sky for times and seasons. So this is part of the season that God is giving us. He is saying to us, this is a picture of the salvation that has come to mankind. And just like it says in Revelation chapter 12, that she was with child, travailing in birth and in pain. It speaks exactly of what we need to hear today as the world is travailing and getting worse and worse. This is what the world needs to see. And this is God saying, look, I'm going to show you in a physical way what you need to know, what you need to believe in, so you will be saved. So signs in the heavens, people. It's out there. There's more I wanted to get into, but we're going to have to leave for next week. I hope you received this today. I hope you enjoyed it. Did you receive this today? Praise God. Amen. Oh, and by the way, I forgot. This happened. Remember September 21st to 23rd? Feast of Trumpets. Feast of Trumpets. In the rapture of the church, the 1 Thessalonians says that Jesus is going to return with the trumpet sound and the voice of the archangel. The trumpet sound represents the Feast of Trumpets. The Feast of Trumpets. Most scholars believe that when the Lord comes back, it's going to be right in the time of the Feast of Trumpets. The trumpet will sound. Hallelujah. And when it has happened? During the Feast of Trumpets. God was saying to the world, my son is about to return very soon. Keep your eyes in the heavens and keep your eyes on my word because he's about to come back very soon. And look at the signs. Everything is happening. Very soon, he's going to appear in the clouds of the air. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah.